Myself, Shweta Shah, and I'm your instructor for the subject microprocessor and microcontroller. In this subject, we are going to start today Unit 3, that is Introduction to 8-bit AVR microcontroller. In this session, we are going to see today the overview of AVR family. So first, let me see what are the outlines for this session. These are like, first we will see the most common MCU and CPU units that are used. Then we will see the 8-bit microcontrollers, then we will see the embedded systems, and then we will see the what are the criteria that we have to keep in mind when we are choosing the microcontroller. Then we will see the AVR microcontroller family and RISC and CISC architecture and Howard and Von Neumann architecture. So first let me see what are the most common MCU and CPU units. MCU stands for the microcontroller unit and CPU stands for the central processing unit. This is like most commonly used microprocessor or microcontroller. If we consider the 8-bit microcontroller unit, then we commonly they are used like 8-bit AVR or PIC or 8051 controller. If we consider the 16-bit, that means it can process 16 bits at a time. Then in a 16-bit category, we are generally using 8086 or 80186 or 8096 or 80196. These are the series of that particular chip, or you can say particular processor. Also we are using 68HC12 or 16. If we consider the 32-bit controlling unit, then we are having the ARM controllers and PIC 32-bit controller. These are the most common controller or processor units that we can use. Okay, this is the list of some companies and their product widely used in 8-bit microcontroller. For Atmel, we are generally using AVR and the 8051 architecture of Atmel. From Microchip, we are using PIC16 or 18. From Intel, we are using 8051 architecture. From Philips, also 8051 architecture. These are the architecture by the specific companies. Okay, but these are generally 8-bit controllers. You can process 8 bits at a time. Okay, so this is the basic list, and this is the their websites from where you can find out it its architecture, its data sheets, and etc. Okay, if we compare the 8051 PIC 18 family and the AVR family, these all are the 40-pin DIP structure. Here you consider the 8051. If we compare the programming ROM, then 8051 has a 8K, PIC has a 32K, and ATmega 32 has a 32K RAM, or you can say ROM, read-only memory available, 32K. Consider the data RAM, then we are available with 256 byte for 8051, 2K for PIC, and 2K for ATmega. EEPROM is not available on the 8051. But for a PIC, we are available with 256 byte, and for ATmega, we are available with 1 kilobyte of EEPROM. If we consider the timers, then on 8051, we are available with the 3 timers. For PIC, we are available with the 4 timers, and ATmega, we are available with 3 timers. And if we consider the input-output pins, which are available for the communication purpose, then for 8052, we are available with 32 pins. For PIC, we are available with 35 pins for the input-output operation, and for ATmega, also 32 pins are available for the input-output operation. Okay, so these three are basically 8-bit controllers, and you can compare it like this. This controller provides this much of ROM, this controller provides this much of ROM, this controller provides this much of timers, this much of input-output pins, and so on. And depending upon your requirement, you can choose the controller. Okay, so this is the basically most commonly used controller units. If we consider the embedded system, then the embedded system is a system that has a control, and it is controlled by its own internal microprocessor or microcontroller unit as opposed to the external control. Okay, so embedded systems are a system which has to do some work plus it has some control internal. Okay, so that are known as the embedded system. If we consider the PC, then we have connected like keyboards or printers or modems or sound card or CD driver, etc. mouse. These all things are the embedded system, which has its own controller. Keyboard has its own controller. Mouse has its own controller. Okay, and that are connected with our PC. So these are the known as the embedded system that has some internal control. Okay, if we consider then the printer gets the data and prints it. A mouse takes the coordinate and sends it to the PC. So it has some control when it required to send the data, when it required to process what. Okay, so that is known as the some control, and the systems are known as the embedded system. If we consider the examples of the embedded system, then that can be, if we consider the computing part, or where we are doing some computing, so that we can say PC is one kind of embedded system where you are using some processing unit or some control is required. If we consider a notebook or laptop or storage devices or printer, laser printer or color printer, or we consider the modem that we are using for connecting for communication, or if we are considering the scanner or digital camera, this all things, digital devices that we are using which require some control, are the embedded product. Okay, next, if we consider the communication product, then the wired or inline telephones or wireless telephones like cellular phones, PDA, pagers, text machine, intercom, etc. are the embedded product. If we consider the cards, like we are using the ATM card or debit card, credit card, debit cards, or electronic purse, or social security, or we are using the cards for the toll tax, etc. are the some controlled device. In that card, there is a chip which controls the transfer. Okay, so these are also a embedded product. If we consider the car, then in car we are using airbags, anti-locking brakes, engine controls, transmission control, climate control, collision avoidance, navigation or trip computer or instrumentation or keyless entry, etc. These all things are require some control to operate that thing. Okay, and whenever you require some control, you can use the controller, and by using that controller, your system will become embedded. Okay, so these are the basic example. If we consider another thing like a consumer product, then we are using VCR, CDs, video games, DVD players, stereos, smoke alarms, cameras, remote control, garage door openers, or security system, etc. All of these things are the embedded things. Okay, if we consider more things like toys or answering machine or camcorder, musical instruments, chewing machines or exercise equipment, all of these things are embedded product. So wherever you are seeing the digital system, this is the embedded system, because it requires some control, and whenever you require some control, you must have control, and your system will become the embedded system. Next, let me see, for example, I want to design some system and I want to choose the controller for that system, that I want to control something and I want to choose which kind of controller I should use for the designing of the system. So I have to keep in mind some criteria. Okay, so let me see which are the criteria that we have to keep in mind whenever we are choosing some controller. First of all, we require to consider the speed. What is the highest speed that this microcontroller supports? Whenever you are seeing some cell phones or etc., in which whenever you are seeing which chip it is using, then there should be written some frequency, on which frequency it is operated. Whenever the frequency is high, that means you are operating it on a higher speed. Okay, for example, if you have two systems, one is operating on the 3 megahertz and another is operating on the 3 gigahertz, then your system which is operating on the 3 gigahertz is the highest, having the highest. Okay, so you have to consider what speed I require, and according to that I have to choose the controller. Second thing I have to keep in mind is the packaging structure, whether it is having dual IP structure or quad flat packaging or some other type of packaging, and which kind of packaging I require to connect with my system. Okay, so you have to keep in mind the same. Then you have to consider the power consumption. This is the critical thing for the battery operated products. Okay, so you have to keep in mind that it consumes the less power. Then you have to consider the amount of RAM and ROM which is required for the chip. Then you have to check for the number of timers and input output pins are available so that you can connect another devices with this controller. Okay, so this thing also you have to keep in mind. And last you have to keep in mind is the cost and availability of the compiler, simulator and debugger for your programs for that particular controller. Okay, next we will see the AVR microcontroller family. The basic architecture of AVR was designed by the two students of Norbin Institute of Technology, whose names are Alf and Vega. And then it was brought and developed by the Atmel in 1996. The AVR stands for Advanced Virtual Risk or Alf-Vega Risk. Okay, and this AVR is a 8-bit RISC single chip microcontroller with Harvard architecture. Here you can see, we have seen the two extra words, that is the RISC and Harvard architecture. Okay, this is basically a 8-bit controller, but it is the RISC, having RISC architecture, or you can say RISC system, and the Harvard architecture is used inside this AVR. So first let me see what is the RISC and CISC, and then we will see the Harvard architecture. So first let me see what is the RISC and CISC. There is two type of architectures are available. First one is the CISC. Whenever we have started for designing the digital system, then first type of architecture is the CISC architecture, that is known as a complex instruction set computer. In this, generally we are having the large number of instructions, typically from 100 to 250 instructions. There are some instructions that performs the specialized task that are used infrequently, like division, multiplication, that are the tasks which are rarely required. But in CISC computers, there is a specific instruction for this task also. Okay, so your instructions becomes larger. The large variety of addressing modes are available for the CISC system, like typically from 5 to 20 different addressing modes. You can directly access or you can directly process the data from the memory. Okay, and there is a variable length of instruction formats are also available. So this is the basically CISC architecture, where you are having large number of instruction, large number of addressing modes, variable length instructions and so on. That means your system designing is complex. Second one architecture format is the reduced instruction set computer, that is RISC architecture. In this, there is the limited instructions, relatively very few instructions and very few addressing modes are used, and all instructions are fixed length and easily decodable. Okay, so that you can use some pipelining structures also with RISC, that is possible. So this is the RISC and CISC architectures comparison. So our ARM architecture is the RISC, based on the RISC architecture. Okay, so it has a relatively few instruction, few addressing modes, fixed length instruction, and it can be easily decoded. Okay, next we will see the Harvard and Von Neumann architecture. In Von Neumann architecture, we are using the same buses for accessing both code and data. Like Pentium processor we are using is based on Von Neumann architecture. While if we consider the Harvard architecture, then there is the separate buses are used for accessing codes and data. Okay, so two different paths are available for the code memory and the data memory. That means we will require the four different sets of buses. Like first one, a set for data bus for carrying data into and out of the CPU. Second bus required is the set of address buses for accessing the data. Third bus is required is the set of data buses for carrying code into CPU, and the address bus for accessing the code. Okay, so basically we are required this four kind of address lines, or you can say four kind of buses for accessing the memories. Okay, and this is easy to implement inside the IC chip, such as a microcontroller, where both ROM code and data RAMs are internally available. So the distance between them will be in terms of micro or millimeter terms. So So these connections can be easily done while you are using or while you are designing the ICs. Okay, so this is the Harvard architecture where you are going to using the different address buses and different data buses for the code and data. Okay, here you have CPU for von Neumann architecture. You have CPU, code memory, and data memory. This all are connected with the single bus. Okay, why for the Harvard architecture this data memory and code memories are connected with CPU with separate buses, like for the separate address bus and separate data bus. Okay, so this is the basic difference between the von Neumann architecture and Harvard architecture. So here we are ending our today's session. If you have any query, then you can contact me.